Hello, everybody. This is Emma Void, back once again with another episode of my Necrobarista Let's Play. Last we left off, we had continued further into the story, found a bunch more little side notes, and also unlocked a new side story. So, I think we're going to go ahead and jump into this now with the new lady we met last time and whoever this guy is? I don't know. We haven't seen him yet. Devil's Den. I hate this job. Kiyoshi was angry. Samantha always found it difficult to see him like this. She felt his anger and his pain as if it were her own. They shared the hurt, a bond exclusive to them. But anger was also a form of passion. And Samantha considered Kiyoshi's passion one of his most admirable qualities. You know I hate it here too, but I can't walk away from this job. Neither of us can. You know the stress is going to kill us one of these days. Stress won't be the thing that kills us. Don't say that. You're right. I'm sorry. I love you. I love you too. Stay safe. Samantha sat alone, nursing a glass of gin. The terminal had a warm atmosphere, a far cry from the immaculate, glitzy pub Holic, where she'd spent just shy of 6 months as a cocktail waitress. In fact, there was almost nothing in this cafe reminiscent of pub Holic, which made it a perfect place to brood, with precious few reminders of her previous gig. There were, of course, the smells. She caught lingering scents as she leaned upon the spirit-stained bar, each one like a stain upon her own memory, a scar that would never heal. Not that she hadn't been left scarred by other jobs, but she resented the invisible stains left on her psyche by Pub Holic, the kind she couldn't hide with concealer and long sleeves. Still, there were a few pleasant memories buried beneath the pain. Memories of him. You want me to just leave the bottle here? No, I need to feel that tiny bit of shame when I ask for a refill. No shame in it. Well, there ought to be. Because without it, I'd hit the bottom of that bottle pretty fast. You want me to stop you? Otherwise, you'll lose that shame soon enough. I'll burn that bridge when I get to it. Samantha liked Maddie. Part of it was the natural kinship she had come to feel for anyone whose profession involved pouring a drink. But Samantha also appreciated Maddie's extremely high level of disinterest in what was going on around her. She could tell from Maddie's eyes that she wasn't all there. Her attention was split between her patrons and some problems she was puzzling together in her head. In Samantha's opinion, patrons always got more attention than they deserved, and it seemed that Maddie agreed. They were perfectly content in their own solitude. Samantha? Is that you? Dun dun dun. Samantha, I'd like to talk to you. Actually, this concerns the other girls, too. Call them over, won't you? Nakamoto made the suggestion as if it had just occurred to him, but it was clear he didn't intend this to be a private conversation. The other servers were within earshot, close enough to hear Nakamoto's request. But he clearly wanted Samantha to beckon them over. She indulged him with the ritual of clapping her hands and calling out, Clara, Iris, Michelle. Business time. As Samantha looked across the table at Nakamoto, she realized that she stood between Nakamoto and the other girls like a protector, a shield. The role fitted her fine, and the other girls seemed grateful for it. But Samantha couldn't help but feel that this was exactly what Nakamoto wanted. Though he was one man facing four women, it felt to Samantha that their numbers were evenly matched. The women standing behind Samantha were not participants, they were mere bystanders. He evidently derived a lot of satisfaction from the fact he never had to raise his voice. He had the subordinates to do that for him. Exemplary work tonight. Mr. Canavan was very impressed. You girls did your job with precision and respect. I would expect nothing less. That deserves a bonus, don't you think? He reached into his breast pocket and pulled out 4 10,000 yen notes, fanning the bills out on an ashtray in front of him. There was only one problem. At the end of the meal, Mr. Canavan suggested that Claire give him a kiss. He got the impression she didn't enjoy it much. Her reaction soured the mood. Perhaps it's not her fault, but we are in the service industry. Our one job is to make clients happy. Samantha locked eyes with Nakamoto, willing him to concentrate his wrath entirely on her and away from the younger, inexperienced girl behind her. Based on that, do you think she should receive this 10,000 yen bonus? Samantha's heart broke for Clara. That she would be complicit in Nakamoto's humiliation of her filled her with guilt, but she kept a steely expression. As much as it bothered her to capitulate, Samantha knew that fighting with Nakamoto would only humiliate Clara further. So she gave the answer he wanted. No, she shouldn't receive the bonus. She knew how Nakamoto's little rituals worked, and she wasn't going to rock the boat. That could only make it worse for all of them.
Is that so? Well, Samantha, if that's what you believe.
Samantha watched as Nakamoto set the edge of one of the bills alight.
What the... Hey! Don't freaking... Come on, don't waste money. What the hell? What a jerk.
The fire rapidly spread until all 4 bills were engulfed. Samantha watched Nakamoto's smiling face through the dancing flames. This was a genuine smile. This was the part he enjoyed.
My, my, what a terrible accident. You see, I only lit Clara's bill, but now everything has been reduced to ash. It's like service, you see. The rest of you provided perfect service for the entirety of the night. But it takes only one small mistake to ruin the entire experience for the client. What one of you does reflects on all of you, on this entire organization. This deserves punishment, don't you think?
Then punish me. I was in charge of planning the events. Any shortcomings during the event are a reflection on my leadership. I take full responsibility.
Ah, hell. Samantha steeled herself for the slap that she knew was coming. She would not flinch. But the slap never came. It took all of Samantha's willpower to not shudder at his caress. The slap would have hurt less to endure.
You're right. You should take responsibility. Punish her.
Clara looked up at Samantha, eyes wet with unshed tears. Samantha's expression softened, and she tried to convey all the sympathy and compassion she could as she mouthed the words, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Mr. Nakamoto.
I'm surprised to see you here. Shall I,
What can I get for you?
She knows what I drink.
He'll have a Manhattan. Do you have Abbott's?
Of course.
This is kind of a long shot, but do you have Hibiki?
I reckon so, yeah. Let me go check in the back.
Thanks, cutie.
Charming girl.
Nakamoto had a habit of describing people as he wanted them to be, rather than as they were. As if he thought calling a server charming were enough to make her want to live up to the description.
Charming, but definitely not your type.
How would you know?
For one thing, she's not subservient enough for your tastes. unlike you, Samantha.
I'm surprised you remember my name.
You wound me. You know I always liked all of the girls at the bar.
Yes, you liked us all so much you gave us the same pet name. I always figured honey was just a more affectionate way of saying, hey you.
Hey you?
As in, hey you over there.
Ah, maybe you are right. But you were always my favorite, Samantha.
Well, one of my favorites.
She wasn't sure if that was meant to be a compliment. Given that Nakamoto seemed to prefer girls too inexperienced to avoid his advances, the implication she might be a favorite struck Samantha as insulting.
You always did like the oblivious ones.
Ah, Samantha, you know how the clan is. We wouldn't have hired you if...
If I were a more sophisticated girl.
No, no.
Nakamoto seemed to think he was being subtle, but he was never very good at it.
I presume the fact that none of the servers spoke Japanese wasn't an accident.
Ah, what is the point in denying it now? Of course you understand now all that was going on.
You only paid in cash. Half your men showed tattoos every time they rolled up their sleeves. Of course I knew what was going on.
But surely you didn't expect...
I always knew it was a possibility. But nobody could have anticipated things happening like they did.
It was never my intention. I tried to do the right thing. My intentions were good.
The road to hell is paved with good intentions.
Samantha glanced again at the white van parked across the road from the bar, then turned away to continue serving, barely noticing the man approaching the bar. A moment later, she tensed up and did a double take. There was something about the way the man walked. Men coming to see Nakamoto were always trembling, afraid. He looked too confident for a man about to talk to an infamous crime boss. That, and the white van. It had been sitting there for the past 2 hours, and yet she hadn't seen anyone come out of the van the whole time. She turned toward the door as the man came in, and realized he was suddenly flanked by several men on the other side. Their chests were too thick for their stature, the kind of bulk that came from Kevlar under suit jackets.
Nobody move!
Samantha found herself looking at a badge, a handgun, and several men holding what looked like military-grade submachine guns.
Taro Nakamoto, we have a warrant for your arrest. I am Taro Nakamoto. Please, no need for the big guns. You're frightening them.
He gestured to the cocktail waitresses huddled behind the bar. Nakamoto stepped forward, intended to turn himself in. His men watched in disbelief, but one by one, they dropped their guns and held their empty hands up. Except for one. He was standing near the door, his right hand hovering at his hip.
Gun!
The young gangster who had drawn the gun crumpled, and several gunshots rang out from the back of the room, another one of Nakamoto's henchmen. Samantha hit the floor, crawling through the shattered fragments of the drink she'd dropped moments ago. The roaring gunfire was so loud it physically hurt her ears. Within seconds, all she could hear was ringing. She kept crawling, trying to avoid the gunfire and stampeding crowd, when she found herself pressed against the side of the bar. Samantha looked up and made eye contact with Nakamoto just seconds before the bullets began to tear him apart. He cratered to the floor, and Samantha found herself face to face with a corpse. As her consciousness faded, two words escaped her lips. Fucking Yakuza.
Of course you didn't mean for it to go down the way that it did. Nobody gets out of bed in the morning thinking, let's die today.
I get up every morning prepared to die. But it is unfair of me to expect everyone around me to do the same. I'm sorry that you had to become involved.
I knew what I was getting into.
You never coerced me.
I made the decision to be there. I made that decision every night I took those envelopes of money home with me.
Don't be absurd. It was my fault entirely. There is no denying that.
You weren't the one who pulled a gun.
Yes, but my man did, and his actions reflect on me.
How can I claim to be the boss if I can't accept that?
Regardless of who's to blame, we both ended up here. Yes, I suppose it is best to enjoy our time here while we still can.
Samantha thought to herself that if her goal was to best enjoy her remaining time here, the first thing to do would be to remove herself from Nakamoto's vicinity. Her distaste for the man had far less to do with the day they were discussing than the months leading up to it. In fact, the way Nakamoto had handled the situation was one of the most decent things he'd ever done, insofar as a crime boss's behavior could be considered decent.
Samantha had spent enough time pretending
Samantha had spent enough time pretending she didn't mind. Take three. Come on, Emma. Samantha had spent enough time pretending she hadn't minded working under him in the past that navigating this conversation took little effort. Now there was nothing that made her feel bound to keep talking to the man. No sense of obligation to keep up appearances. There was only one thing keeping her in that seat, listening to Nakamoto. A need for answers.
Sorry, didn't find any Hibiki back there. Found some Shibuimaru, though, so that's what you're getting.
What a treat. Thank you, Miss...
Maddie.
Thank you, Miss Maddie. I drink these slow, but I hope you'll have another ready by the time I finish this one. You know, I forbade my men to drink our rival's whiskey. For me to drink it myself would be hypocritical.
And yet, here you are. Nobody's watching you, so I don't think you have to worry about that now.
Except for you.
Well, I won't tell. And besides, you are the boss.
In that case, perhaps there are pleasures which we are only allowed to enjoy in death. It may be my deceased condition that makes it so, but I would be a liar to claim this isn't the best drink I have ever had.
Forbidden fruit is always the sweetest.
Had I tasted this drink years ago, perhaps we could have ended our turf war on more amicable terms. I find it hard to resent men who make such fine whiskey.
He started laughing, and Samantha joined him, more out of practiced reflex than shared mirth. Nakamoto placed his hand on her leg. She didn't flinch, but she looked at him with just the right amount of withering contempt to make him withdraw his hand.
You're a very powerful woman.
From the lips of the notorious Yakuza boss to the ears of the tittering cocktail waitress.
You have an aura about you. Even when you served drinks, you had a dominant energy. Everyone in the room always respected you. I wanted to make you mine.
So why didn't you?
Because if I had taken you, I would have destroyed the very thing I admired about you. I wanted you to come to me willingly.
And you thought I would?
If I'm to be honest, yes. You seemed like the type of woman who'd be drawn to men of power.
I don't particularly find power that impressive when it's measured in number of dollars laundered.
Power, not money. You do crave power. I can always see it in your eyes.
And yet somehow I managed to resist your charms.
Nakamoto smiled at Samantha, having completely missed the cutting sarcasm of her remark.
Besides, I didn't move to the city expecting to find love, especially not among the ranks of crime syndicates.
No, But you found it anyway.
You're right.
What was his name?
You know his name.
Yes, but I want to hear you say it.
Kiyoshi. Kiyoshi, what's wrong, baby?
Don't worry.
Your heart is beating so fast. Something's bothering you.
You know how I am. My heart always starts racing whenever I'm in bed with a beautiful woman.
Stop it. What's really happening?
I shouldn't tell you.
And we shouldn't be together right now. That hasn't stopped us.
It's Nakamoto-san. He has eyes for you.
You think I don't know that? Anyone can tell by looking at him.
I'm worried that he will try to take you away from me.
I won't let him. I can look out for myself.
That is what bothers me. One day, Nakamoto will try to take you, and you won't let him. Nakamoto does not take kindly to being snubbed.
Let me deal with that.
I hate that man.
Shh, don't say that.
Why shouldn't I say it? I hate him.
Anyone could be listening.
If the walls have ears, then let them hear.
How can you stand it, serving him every day from under his oppressive thumb? I do it the same way you do. One day at a time.
My father told me Nakamoto was a despicable man. I should have listened to him. I feel it deep in my soul, Samantha. If we stay here, bad things will start to happen.
We're good at surviving bad things.
Not like this. There are some things you can't survive. There are some things you need to run away from.
You know we can't do that.
There may be a way.
What are you saying?
Samantha, before I tell you, I need to know.
Will you come with me?
What are you planning?
Tell me first. If I do this, we can never come back to this city. Will you come with me? Will you leave them behind?
Nakamoto is not the kind of man that you can simply walk away from.
He will be when I am done. Samantha, tell me now. Will you come with me?
I can't.
Of course you can. The question is, will you?
Kiyoshi. His name was Kiyoshi.
You're not like the others.
Samantha regarded the young, cocksure man standing before her. One of Nakamoto's men. She knew his name was Kiyoshi. Samantha, of course, had made a point of memorizing the names of all of the men who worked under Nakamoto. But she was aware admitting she knew who he was would be taken as a sign of flattery, so she played dumb.
I'm sorry, you're one of Nakamoto's men, right?
Why do you do that?
Do what?
Play dumb. You know that I am one of Nakamoto's men. You know my name.
Not everyone knows your name.
You're right. In fact, very few people do. I am not as memorable as some of my peers. But you remember my name regardless. You know everyone else by name. There's not a chance that you don't know who I am.
I'm forgetful.
Funny. You always seem to remember people's names when it's important.
What are you saying?
I am saying that you seem to enjoy privately embarrassing Nakamoto's men, while having the good sense to never publicly humiliate them. I'm not bothered by it, if that's what you're wondering. but you are a lot more clever than you allow others to believe.
That makes two of us.
She was beginning to think that the soft-spoken Kiyoshi was a lot more attentive than any of Nakamoto's henchmen were, and that made her uneasy. But she knew that he had already gotten whatever he wanted from this conversation.
We're not so different, you and I.
I disagree.
She didn't see the need to list the various ways in which they differed in both station and demeanor.
Perhaps you are right.
You have the courage to show the men how little you care for them.
I lack that courage.
But it's clear that you and I both feel the same way about them.
Either way, you're not like the others.
I was wondering if you'd ever notice. I always did like Kiyoshi. He always bowed when he needed to. He always said the right things. But he showed contempt with every bow, every action. He had a way of insulting you even as he delivered a compliment. Very against what I usually look for in my men. But he had courage, determination,
moxie.
I can see why a woman like you would be attracted to him. I always worried about him, but I knew that he was destined to do great things. Who knows? Perhaps one day he could replace me.
Who will replace you?
Who can say? Many of my lieutenants were there that day, my right and left hands. In all the time that she had known him, Nakamoto had never been a man to lean. He always stood stiff as a board, his spine so rigid that it seemed he was afraid that it would snap if he allowed it to bend even in the slightest. That rigid posture, along with his platform heels, allowed Nakamoto to pass for several inches taller than he really was. Samantha had suspected it was his attempt to make himself seem more physically imposing. But to her, it always had the opposite effect, making him appear comically uncomfortable in his own body. Then again, Nakamoto was never a man who had coveted luxury for himself, so perhaps his self-inflicted discomfort was in character. And that made his physical relaxation so unsettling. This was a side of Nakamoto she had never seen, but perhaps this side would be willing to talk. How many people do you suppose died in that pub?
Perhaps a better question would be who managed to survive.
Perhaps they are just like us, waiting to walk through that door. Perhaps that would be a better fate for them. Any who survived will surely be arrested. After all, if I had been arrested, I would not be here enjoying this very fine whiskey.
Maybe they escaped?
I doubt that very much. Yakuza do many things. Running is not one of them. Besides, have you seen Gojiri? That man is too fat to outrun anyone.
This guy's kind of a dick, just like constantly. Even when he's trying to be like, oh yeah, I was awful and I'm sorry, and he's still a dick.
Samantha, you don't have to keep pretending. I know that you don't like me. My men always told me that it was just your Western manner of flirting, that you were teasing, playing at being hard to get. But I know contempt when I see it.
You think I hold you in contempt?
No. I was speaking of the men who offered me false flattery. You don't like me. But who can blame you? It is the nature of hierarchy. Hatred for the organization is always directed upward. It's a healthy and natural thing, is it not? Better to resent the people above you than to resent the people working next to you. It is, in a way, a powerful tool for bonding. It is something that you all went through together, and that made you closer, did it not?
I never really became close friends with any of the other girls.
No, I thought not. But I wasn't talking about them. You know who I am talking about. Nakamoto was part of a dying generation. I'm pretty sure that's how all generations work. They have to die sometime. They make room for new generations. This generation of Yakuza will not die out. It will be chased out. It is a slow-moving organization. Everything about it from the inside out is based on an old way of doing things that is rapidly becoming not only outdated, but painful to look at. The premise of a clan is founded on the expectation that all of its members will be members for life, bound to each other in the organization. Death is the only solution. Kiyoshi, you don't mean to. This whole organization needs to die, though it will take 10 years of my life along with it. It has given me something that I hate, and yet I can't bring myself to give it up. In a way, it has become a part of me. You are not your job. Nakamoto would disagree. So would my parents, including my uncle who is a police. Things are different for you, but where I am from, this is true of any sort of institution or organization. The first 10 or 20 years that you spend in the organization are not truly spent doing anything of substance. The purpose of your first decades is training you to be a member of the clan. Sounds like an extensive training program. I didn't realize that Yakuza valued training and education so highly. It is not a training program as you might imagine it. Most of it is being subjected to artificial hardships to demonstrate that you are trustworthy and loyal to the clan. Many of these hardships are designed to be humiliating or otherwise damaging. This is not an overlooked flaw of the initiation process. It is intentionally that way by design. Like hazing.
Hazing?
It's a practice for initiating people into social groups. It's not just a Yakuza thing, I assure you. You do this in your home country. I was hazed several times in college. Sororities, other honor societies, that sort of thing. Ah. Organizations addicted to the old ways of doing things.
I suppose so.
Hazing is a torch passed on from one generation to the next. And I suppose the upside is that you get a bunch of loyal foot soldiers.
No. The upside is that you get a large number of people who will only perpetuate the institution, complete with all its flaws. You need to find a way to clear the ranks, burn it all to the ground, start from scratch.
Better yet, burn it all to the ground and leave it smoldering.
I wish I could. And yet there is something deep in me that would hate to see it so.
I know how much you hate Nakamoto.
But you see, I don't. Even if I want to hate him, I cannot. The kind of loyalty that is built up over many years, it does not go away simply because you wish it to. That is the insidious thing about this organization. It changes you, even as you realize what it is doing to you, even as you hate it. For me to say that I hate Nakamoto would be the same as saying that I hate what I've become. And that is not something I say easily, even though it may be true.
You are not like Nakamoto.
I wish what you say was true.
You're right. Kiyoshi hated you.
Did he tell you that?
Samantha didn't bother to answer Nakamoto's question. She hated rhetorical questions with a passion. Several moments of silence later, she noticed Nakamoto fidgeting. Nakamoto was a man who carried himself with an undue amount of pomp, and it was not easy to make a man that straight-laced fidget. She took a certain amount of pleasure from his visible discomfort. The thought occurred to her that the way she tried to get a certain reaction from Nakamoto was not so different from his habit of dominating conversations. But she justified this to herself easily. The worst thing about Nakamoto was that he was a poor steward of power.
He diminished the power of others because he enjoyed taking it for himself, and he correctly perceived it as being zero-sum. Samantha did crave power, but she very much enjoyed seeing Nakamoto being brought down a few notches, even if only for a moment.
Of course he told you all the ways he despised me and my old ways. That is how every passionate relationship begins, is it not? The strongest bonds are built not out of mutual respect, but out of a shared hatred for someone or something. So of course he would pick me as the object of ire to win you over. Kiyoshi was a very shrewd man. He'd always had a talent for getting exactly what he wanted.
You don't know the first thing about what kind of man Kiyoshi was. He's far more dangerous than he looks.
I don't carry a gun. Too dangerous.
Not when you know how to use one.
I don't mean dangerous to safety. Dangerous to get caught with. Guaranteed jail time on conviction.
And yet, somehow all your friends seem to deal with it.
Colleagues, not friends.
So, how come they bear the risk of getting caught with a firearm and you don't?
I need to stay clean. The clan has many properties in my name. If I were caught carrying a firearm, it would defeat the purpose.
I didn't realize you had an ownership stake in the clan.
Technically I do. But do you think I actually see any of the money that passes through my establishments? They use my name, but I have no power.
And if you ever try to leave...
Yes. Now you understand why things are so complicated. Even if I leave, I will still carry the taint of association. There's no avoiding it.
Why you? Why not do it under someone else's name?
I may have lied to you before. I told you I don't carry a gun because there are many properties under my name. They needed someone who looked squeaky clean.
Squeaky clean? Someone with a spotless record. Perfect. Free of imperfections.
That's me. Mr. Spotless. Though I don't think that anyone in the clan would describe me that way. I'm actually very far from perfect. I am just the man that they needed.
I think you're what I need, too.
What does that mean?
You may not be perfect, but you're what I'm looking for right now.
You don't want to be tied up with me. I can't endure these circumstances. How could I expect you to do the same? You need to escape. It's too late for me, but not for you.
It's not too late.
I have nowhere to turn to. I've been thinking of going to the police.
Kiyoshi looked at her with pained eyes, unable to say anything more. Finally, Samantha spoke up. Are you going to?
No deal. They would not be able to make a deal without me agreeing to testify against him. And that is something I cannot do. Not without fearing for my own life. No matter where Nakamoto is, he will find me. Even dead, his ghost would haunt me. My only option is to disappear. My own crimes are far too great to be forgiven, even if I do betray Nakamoto. And besides, I cannot trust the police.
I mean, yeah, true.
If there's even one corrupt officer who allows my name to escape... Nakamoto has one principle, and one principle alone. Dead men can't talk.
There are always more options.
You're right. I could inform the police anonymously. Send them to where they can confront one of Nakamoto's deals directly. I know when he's having one of his business meetings, but it won't be pretty. You're the only person I can tell this to. Because when the police finally catch up with him, people will die. I don't want you anywhere near there when it happens. Can you promise me this?
Kiyoshi, I
need to tell you something. You can't go to the police. Tell me why I shouldn't. You'll ruin everything. This life is already ruined. The best I can hope for now is a chance at atonement. This may not make things better, but I cannot think of how they would become any worse with me. Worse would I continue to serve under that. Please, Kiyoshi. I have a plan to subvert Nakamoto. All the more reason for me to go to the police. I can't allow you to be the one to run into harm's way. You don't understand. This will work. You think you're the first one to think about taking Nakamoto down? People much stronger than you, people much more well-connected than you have tried it before. How could you possibly succeed where they have failed? Okay. Here we go. Kiyoshi, you were right. I'm not like the others. There's something very different about me. Tell me.
Well, if you believe that you know Kiyoshi better than I do, you are welcome to think it. Though I don't see how that could possibly be the case. I have spent more than a decade with the man. He was never just a servant to me. Not even close. The boss must hold the respect of his men. It is a powerful bond.
Nakamoto sounded frustrated, but his voice grew increasingly soft.
Do you believe that your months-long fling with him really meant more than that? Do you really have the ability to look into a man's eyes, to peer into his soul, and sense his true desires and motives? You are truly a fool if you believe this.
Samantha found herself taken aback by Nakamoto's aggressive speech. For a moment, she thought that perhaps Nakamoto was right, that she didn't have the soul read on him. But as the moment passed, she came to an infuriating realization. Nakamoto pitied her. Do not underestimate me. As she felt the words leaving her lips, she found herself instantly regretting it. There was no faster way to lose respect than to demand it like a petulant child. She appeared weak and desperate, traits she saw mirrored in the man sitting across from her. Nakamoto wanted only to toy with her. She needed a punch to throw him off guard, something unexpected. She needed to tell the truth. I hate you. It does not surprise me to hear that you feel that way. It does, however, surprise me to hear you say it out loud. I don't think you understand the extent of it. I detest you. Not for what you did to me, but for what you did to everyone who worked under me. If you hate me so much, why don't you just kill me? You're already dead. You never understood, but I did. Every single word you spoke in every single one of your business meetings. I wasn't the dumb little American girl you thought I was. Part of me always thought that a girl like you seemed too sophisticated to be a simple drink server. So who are you reporting to? Police? Give yourself more credit. It's not just the cops who've got their eyes on you. And give me some more credit. I'm no mere informant. So what are you? CIA. Part of a 2-year investigation. So you were out to get me from the start, were you? Are you happy that you finally brought me down? Happy that you put me in a body bag? It was a job. I did my duty. I'm sure that, as a career criminal, you can relate. You don't always get to do the things you want to do. Sometimes, you do the thing that has to be done. So, everything went all according to your plan? Not all according to plan. Part where bullets started flying and I ended up here. That definitely wasn't part of the plan. I expected that you'd try to end things peacefully.
Well, I guess things went wrong for both of us.
And here we are, doomed to enjoy the same fate.
Ha Well, since you've been so generous in sharing your secrets with me, I suppose I should respond in kind. Samantha. I'm not Nakamoto.
Samantha sat stunned. She had, on occasion, considered the possibility that Nakamoto might merely be a figurehead, that he might just be a middle manager in a larger organization. But all of the important meetings had always taken place at Pub Holic. She hadn't been party to every discussion or meeting, but she knew it was the place where decisions were made. If the man sitting in front of her wasn't the true boss, then it must have been someone else in that room.
I'm his henchman. I exist solely for one purpose. For the day that someone tries to kill Nakamoto, or worse, they get me instead. I assure you that the real boss is safe and sound by now. He's probably on a boat out of the country as we speak.
She knew that the real ringleader must have been one of the men who sat in the meetings at Pub Holic. Every face she had recognized had been there the day of the CIA crackdown. It had been scheduled during a meeting. Even if Nakamoto wasn't the true ringleader, the ringleader by now had been arrested, if not one of the men shot to death.
All of your men were there when the police showed up. None could have escaped arrest, or worse. There was one who was absent.
Nakamoto. Sorry, guess I shouldn't call you that. Do you have a real name?
I suppose there's no harm in discussing it now. My name is Kiyoshi.
Dun 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 dun.
Yes, I stepped into Nakamoto's shoes, and in turn he stepped into mine. A simple switcheroo. How embarrassing for you.
So that means the real Nakamoto.
For me to say that I hate Nakamoto would be the same as saying that I hate what I've become.
The real Nakamoto.
Yes, your lover boy was really the big villain you hoped to take down.
Samantha reeled. Physical fatigue, anxiety, panic, these were things she had learned to stave off long ago. Nakamoto wasn't sharp enough to realize just how rare it was for Samantha to find herself dizzy like this, but he did know that he had gotten a reaction out of her.
You know you're probably dead right now because of him.
I bet that kid in the bar pulled the gun because Kiyoshi. Because the real Nakamoto told him to.
You may be right. Perhaps he left me to die. But then, that is my job as a decoy. To be ready to die when the boss requires it. In fact, he warned me it might be happening. I spoke with him before. He told me you gave him immunity. Mr. Big Bad, never to see trial.
That's not how it works. He can still be charged, but who will charge him?
Why would they charge a small fry like Kiyoshi? As far as everyone is concerned, the Big Bad boss is now dead. Most of the potential witnesses too, I imagine.
One of Nakamoto's greatest strengths was his ability to project a veneer of stoicism. He was always the sort of man that expressed his power subtly, never flexing, always taking pride and never raising his voice. But in this moment, he was reveling. He had nothing to gain and nothing to hide, and he was clearly enjoying watching Samantha squirm. She saw no reason to continue obliging him. Samantha didn't bother to look behind her to see if he was following. He desperately wanted to continue enjoying his victory, and Samantha wasn't turning around to give it to him.
Samantha!
By calling out to her, it was practically an admission of defeat on his part. He needed her to see that he was victorious in order to enjoy the moment. A small, petty man, obsessed with status. So obsessed that in pursuit of it, he had given up the only remaining standing he had left. And so, Samantha couldn't resist succumbing to the same temptation.
You have lost everything. The one you thought you could trust betrayed you, and no one will be around to avenge the betrayal.
No one outside this place will ever know of it.
I know of at least one person who will.
Oh.
Kiyoshi. Did I ever say I was dead?
Rip.
Thanks for the tip about Nakamoto. I'm sure he'll never believe how I found out about his identity. What was it he said to me? The dead can't talk. Maybe he needs to rethink that.
She started to turn around, but the one thing that stopped her was the look in his eye. The look of someone who was finally unhinged and realized that he truly had nothing left to lose, not even his own dignity. It was the look of a man who was ready to fight. Samantha had spent 6 months working under the man she knew as Nakamoto, observing him as he did business with myriad parties. Before, she thought she knew what it meant to see him angry in the moment when he flexed his power over his underlings. She thought she knew what a wrathful Nakamoto looked like. She realized now that the anger she'd seen from him previously was simply cold, calculated malice. This was rage. He came at her with a flailing, amateurish punch. His arms were longer than hers, but she'd trained for this. Samantha drove her fist into his chest. Against a being of flesh and blood, this would be an instant knockout. Nakamoto didn't even register the hit. Samantha watched as he lunged downward, his hands reaching toward her throat, waiting for the last possible moment to kick him away. Samantha heard an unpleasant crunch as his hand bore the weight of his fall. A crunch, but no howl of pain. He was already up, his hand quickly erasing any sign that it had sustained the fall.
You!
It was only the inertia of her kick that had forced him back, and once he regained his footing, he came at her again. Samantha couldn't stop Nakamoto in hand-to-hand combat. The cafe's enchantments kept his customers' bodies intact as best it could. But as with everything that stood in Samantha's way, she found a workaround. She drew her piece, a Pieta revolver with a wooden grip. Her gun's brass construction recalled an era when steel was scarce and superstition and fear of ghosts was anything but. It was no coincidence, then, that the black powder weaponry of the 19th century was perfectly built for causing real, tangible harm to wayward spirits. She let out a yell and pushed the weapon into his chest, unloading the shot. By the time the 44 round passed through him, his body was already stitching itself back together. But the black powder from the gun's discharge remained inside him. He howled in pain as his body tried to reconstitute itself around his fatal chest wound. His flesh was in constant war of trying to warp itself to cover the hole, and flinching away from the sulfur powder that was beginning to seep deeper and deeper into his body.
How? Nakamoto. No. Kiyoshi. Did you think we met here by accident? Did you think I hadn't come prepared?
He tumbled to the ground and rolled over on his side, trying to get up on his one good leg.
You've styled yourself a prince of thieves. He fell to the ground in a slump, raised his one good arm, and reached out to her like an animated corpse, trying to take the living with him. But now, you'll die like a dog. Goodbye, Kiyoshi.
Go to hell!
I'm done. Need any materials extracted? Just my 44. I'm taking a commercial flight out. Why can't you just use standard equipment like the rest of us? Tell me which part of my job description includes the word standard. Abnormal jobs call for abnormal equipment. Life would be easier if you didn't have such a specific taste in guns. Believe me, Nothing about this is about my taste in guns. This thing is a brute of a weapon. Poor construction, nearly impossible to grip, and a recoil shield that's not worth a damn. It's the only gun that makes you feel like your hands are somehow too big and too small at the same time. It bucks like a motherfucker. It's single action, so you have to flip the hammer with every shot, and it was on the wrong side of one of the bloodiest wars in world history. I hate this gun. So why use it? It carries the stink of slave owners and sulfur with it everywhere it goes. I hate it. Spirits hate it even more. Like oil and water. More like a fatal allergic reaction. If you ever need to bring a walker to its knees, bring a black powder revolver. I think I'll leave that to you. I have some important information about the informant. Kiyoshi? Yes, but that's not his real name. I would have figured. Do you know where he is? Did someone get to him? What? He somehow vanished off our radar this morning. I was worried someone had taken him out. He disappeared. Yes, did Nakamoto tell you anything about that? Hello. No, everything went exactly as planned. Just need to get rid of some deadwood. No, I'm working on something new. Rebuilding. That was a hell of a side story. Like, holy jeez. Okay, so, the writing in this game, in general, pretty good. I like it. The writing in the side stories, holy crap. Like, they really go all out on these things, don't they? Oof. Well, I think that's enough for today's episode. Thanks so much for watching, everybody. Be sure to come back next time, when we'll continue on, and possibly finish up the plot? I don't know, let me... We've got... No, not this one. Here we go. So there seems to be two acts, unless there's a third act that I don't know about, which would mean four more chapters after this, after these last ones. So, we'll see how long that takes. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, all the other usual YouTube garbage, and I'll see you next time. Bye, everybody!